Yeah, that's the Capitol.
Let's walk around to the left. Well, wait a minute. We can go through the...
Want to go through the courtyard?
I'm not scared.
Let's try. What? Washington used to have some of his favorite dinners. The restaurant there. Gates?
Daddy, look at that tree.
This was like.
Didn't we go in here before?
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's on.
I know.
Doesn't look like it. Haven't we been here before?
Yep. Is this the jail?
This is the jail.
I heard about this.
Public jail and general court prison.
What kinds of things does one have to do to end up in jail?
Most definitely it's wrong.
Like stealing roosters or?
Yeah. Probably would be stealing roosters. You'd probably round up in the stocks.
Where are the stocks, by the way?
Down by the courthouse.
They're down by the courthouse.
They used to be right out here. I figured they were lesser offenses, so they wouldn't probably wind up in this spot.
And I suppose part of the stocks was to make it more visible and embarrassing, so they'd want to put it in the common areas.
Right.
And did you have real crimes here? Like, I mean, serious crimes? Were there murders in the streets, people shooting each other, or?
Oh, I suppose they did. You're going to have a seat here for a moment, and then we'll be going in. How would that be? Would you like that?
Sounds great.
The jail keeper?
Yes, this is one of the original buildings, which has been restored, dates back to 1704.
Over there and a stair at the end of the passage going to more bedchambers above stairs. There were two lockup cells for women within the building here. They'd be up on the second floor. They had a debtor cell, which was used very seldom. They changed the law such that if you put a person into jail for debt, you had to pay for his expense. So they didn't use that very long at all. Sounds practical, doesn't it? In a middle-class house, you'd be furnished about like you see here. You'd have a sort of a status symbol of a map as a decoration in the room. You'd have some merchant goods, a punch bowl and coffee and tea sets. And you'd have some prints on the wall. And if you were really wanting to look affluent, you'd put up a looking glass, because looking glasses were quite expensive in those days. You know, this is a holding jail for the general court. They did not punish people by locking them up. They thought that was cruel and unusual punishment, and it cost the county, the colony, too much money to lock people away for punishment, so they just didn't do it. They did have very strict and very well-known rules about crime. The ladies got the same punishment as the men. If they stole a horse and were convicted, judged to be guilty, they'd be hanged. Just like the man would. Whippings, they would get fewer lashes. The ladies would get 29 lashes, the men would get 39 lashes on the bare back, well laid on. So the crime rate was fairly low. People knew the rules, and they knew they'd get punished, and they would be punished very swiftly after they were convicted, because if you were judged to be guilty, you'd be put back in the jail until the last day of the court session. On that day, all the ones that were in jail that were guilty would be taken back up to the court, and their sentences would be read. Within the next 10-day period, all the sentences would be carried out. whether it be hanging, whether it be whipping, whether it be the banishment from the colonies, all of those burning in the hand with a hot iron to mark you as a criminal. All of those would be taken care of in 10 days. So four times a year they cleaned out the jail. The food here wasn't very good. It was water, corn cakes, and some salted meat. If you're rich, you could have food sent in from the taverns uptown or have some friends bring you some food. The blacksmith would come over and make you an ankle bracelet of cast iron, and you'd have a chain on that over to a ring in the floor. That's as far as you could go, the length of that chain. That would allow you to get over to the indoor toilet, because they had indoor toilets for the safety of the jailer, primarily. So, you had rather primitive conditions here in the jail. In the wintertime, it was very cold. You had no fireplaces at all in the cells. So they just had to get as much clothing as they could in to try to survive. Some of them didn't after they changed the court four times a year, because one of those times was in December. So it's pretty rough here. The most famous of our jailers was Peter Pelham. He had a very large family, and he supplemented his income by being the organ master up at the Root Parish Church, and he also taught music. He had been trained in England as an organist. He was a very prominent man around town. It was a political appointment by the General Court. I'll let you see the cells now by going down to the end. Then go out to the exercise yard.
Well, I don't know what we're going to see in here at all.
It's the jail cell.
This is the jail cell? It was a holding area until such time as they could mete out the crime, and that was it. So this is how you couldn't break out of this too easy, could you?
This was the place on fire.
It's very, very dark in here. What are these things, Susan?
Gosh.
What are these for?
I think these are...
Hand on their food or something?
Maybe the food was sent in through the air.
Or... I don't know.
No, it looks right. It goes right through another jail.
Yeah.
There's another one in there that looks right through there.
Oh, that? These are the outside. Uh-huh. That's a young hoodlums in here. Put those handcuffs on here. Can you put them on Lori?
They knocked there and they took out that and they passed
them. Oh, I see. That's how they
handed
it.
They had to come outside and do it.
Right. They wouldn't have to open the door. They'd lock them up. That's where the food was passed through. And this is the open court where they let them come out and have a little...
See the change?
Yeah. Wow. Okay, this is not a fun place to be.
No, I think this would deter me from doing anything.
Well, they said basically that if you broke in and stole something, they hung you.
That was the end of it.
That's it. You wouldn't do it again. Too expensive to maintain.
I wonder how fair the trial was.
I don't know. Well, that was interesting. Did we lose two of our inmates?
Right.
We lost our inmates.
Brian,
there.
Yeah. Have you looked at your watch?
Guys, where are we going now? Is this a potato cellar?
That's where everything's relative.
Everything's relative, yeah.
Because in those days, if you had a roof over your head, warmth in your house, and clothes on your back, you probably thought you were rich.
Well, that's the whole... I mean, after you've seen Jamestown, Yeah. This was a town.
I have to admit, seeing Jamestown gives you a different respect for what you're seeing here.
These people really felt.
So Williamsburg. I thought, oh my God, how did they do this?
Yeah, but now. Jamestown was really savage. I mean, it was living out literally in shack.
Savage, right? Primitive, yes.
Very primitive, and at least.
Look at the stream.
At least here they could feel like they're part of a town, a real town.
You're videotaping that.
With homes. But this was the capital of all of Virginia. So he said it served 500,000 people. They were brought in from anywhere around Virginia to be brought here.
Oh, I want to go down to down. Where we were last time, downtown, a real thing.
Well, that's right down the street here. Go up to the top of the hill here and turn right. This is where George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, and
Patrick Henry,
William Fry, Samuel Fry, excuse me.
William Fry?
Yeah.
Oh, Fry. Oh, God, I love it. That's worse
all of
than
them
Wolf.
Came here. There we go.
Daddy, look at that tree.
Why do they allow bicycles? I thought they weren't allowing anything.
Daddy, look at that tree. This is the weirdest tree I've ever seen, Daddy.
Yeah? How come they're allowing bicycles in here? I thought this was supposed to be authentic. Mm-hmm. Seems like the bicycles take something away.
Ew!
Horsey poop.
Big.
Daddy, you're filming nothing. What's that?
Let's call the house.
This is where, this Shields Tavern where we ate.
I know what it is.
Yeah.
I know what it is.
That was last time.
Maybe it wasn't Shields Tavern. Maybe it was the other tavern down the street.
No, wait.
You think we ate upstairs there?
It had two stories.
It's about right, Daddy. I think that's it.
Why?
I think it might have been a little bit. I think we had reservations here, but we got in down there.
No, we made the reservations in the state.
Yeah, we did today.
Guess who's that one?
Nicholson's store.
Ew, Daddy, you're walking in bird. I mean.
Walking in horse poop, am I? Christianity's. That's where George Washington ate at. This is a very famous place because in this place is where Patrick Henry said, "Give me liberty or give me death."
Remember, Sonia?
This is where Patrick Henry said it because they met in here after the governor said, "Well, I've heard your appeals and I'm going to ignore them all." And they said, "What are we going to do? Are we going to take this?" He said, "Taxation without representation." That's what he said. "Give me liberty or give me death" was John Paul Jones.
What? You're mixing people up just for the fun of it.
And
now you're making me think of a Paul Revere. I don't know why.
"Here's Johnny,"
Daddy,
said Ed McMahon.
"Look at this rock.
Take a picture of us."
Sure. At least Devon knows half the speed.
You should have seen that rock, Daddy. It looked like a Bigfoot. Daddy, will you come look at it?
I wonder if they're still open. Let's go see.
You all can sort of feel the different fibers that are on our table if you like.
that's a yak. The rest are humans. Then the horsehair wig is this black wig with the bow and the, I'm sorry, right here, the bow and the two side curls. Those are, I mean, that's a horsehair wig. So real back then just simply meant anything alive, not necessarily human hair.
What do the guys have underneath those wigs?
It is a custom-made wig, meaning to fit his head. They would literally shave off all the hair that was on their heads, and they were thrown away, and then he used someone else's hair.
Oh.
Yeah, the head, it was custom-made to shave it. You saw the cap on the table, on the mushroom stand, yeah, with the flowers on it.
Uh-huh.
That's what the men wore. And females wore mob caps on her shaven head. You know, she had a wig custom-made also.
What held them on?
Sheer luck.
Must have been tough on a fast ride on a horse.
Huh? Well, I can see them flipping the wig many a time. It was not secure.
It's not a pretty sight, huh? Yul Brynner would have felt at home.
Yeah, he would have been in style.
How hot were they on there?
They were hot and itchy and irritating, but you look good.
That's important.
Around the 1780s or 90s, and there's one account we read in 1812. That's the last that we say. But again, they're still worn by the judges and barristers in London, England, so it hasn't, you know, totally died out.
What would a wig cost you?
It varied. Let's use the brown wig on that second shelf. £2, 3 shillings. That's a month working wage of a journeyman craftsman. That's equivalent to 4 pairs of shoes or a complete suit of clothing for a man or a wig. Some wigs are valuing from 4 month working wages up to 2 years. Or guess what the governor paid for his white wig? It was made out of human hair and it valued at £60 sterling, which is 2 years working wages of a tobacco or head of course and painted, but he never wore a wig. Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, Patrick Henry, all shaved men wore them at that time.
When did the practice start?
Oh, we can date them far back as to the Egyptian, and they were shaving at that time period for the fear of lice. Now, but in 1624, the King of France was losing his hair, so he shaved his head and wore a wig, and what royalty does, everybody wants to follow suit, so it becomes a fashion. See, like today, we lose it, we go out and buy it because of necessity. But just make yourself bald, that's fashion.
Or not like broccoli. Or, right.
It was coming from girls that lived on farms in Europe that had grown it and sold it to a wig maker, Sarah Peppers. And then they gave her bottles of perfume, costume, jewelry. Exactly. She never had much in her lifetime. To her, that was a treasure, a bottle of perfume, all for her hair. Let's see, hair hanging against the wall. That's all they might just give her. Some type of pretty lace handkerchief, costume, jewelry for her hair. It all depends. And then when everything else fails, then you're going to give her some money. And they even had hair nappers run behind you with scissors and cut it off your head, and you got nothing for it.
Hair
nappers.
Hair nappers,
yeah.
They come run up behind you and clip it off.
Someone would strike you, run behind you with scissors, and just cut it off. Keep running. That was what they did. This is report.
Wow. Wow.
Is this dyed or is it
a natural? This is a natural color for yaks. Your yaks are coming in different colors.
So it has to be, this is one yak or this is
dyed?
This one, if you want to make it into like dyeing for fabric, it's natural to be permanent.
Mm-hmm.
But you can get that out. But you have to mix it with flour to tone the color down.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Before you mix it with flour, let's say the woman was in need of lipstick or rouge. That's what they use for gloves. That dye is red dye number 2.
That's red dye number 2.
So if you go to Europe today, you still find this dye on the market. It's not poison, but it is used. And the blue is from indigo, and the tan is ground up walnut chips. Mm-hmm. And before you pump the powder into the hair, there is something on the table that looked like oatmeal.
Yeah, right here.
Actually, it's not. It's perfume pomade. You have to smear it into the hair style and then pump the powder into the hair. Mm-hmm. That is powder.
Oh, I see.
Okay. You're attending different colors for the evening. Mm-hmm. And when they tint the powder, when they tint the hair white, then they use flour, starch, talcum powder, and for extreme emergency, lime or plastered Paris. I just hate to see it get wet and hard. Oh, on the table, there's a little round ball of soap that looked like a potato. It's right there. It's like an ivory. It's very mild. What's so tedious in making it? You all see the hair on that loom with the brown hair?
Mm-hmm.
You have to weave every hair on that loom in order to make it into a wig.
Yeah, it's
140 hours.
140 hours
to make.
What you're all seeing right here that I'm about to show you, this is what's been woven. I'm going to show you how we create this. This is what we call a weft of hair. And what you're doing is that when you place it onto the base, this is just a demo piece, but if we were going to make it into a wig, you backstitch each row, a layer, then you continue to build. But to make this, you start right here. I'll show you how it's done. When you weave the hair, you're not counting the strands. We know by feel. And it's really difficult when you don't have much, when you're not really working with much light. You take the hairs and weave it and make yourself an M pattern. See?
Uh-huh.
And then you pull it down and then you slide it. And that's the technique. That's the weaving.
Oh. How long does it take one to learn to make a hair?
It doesn't take that long. The technique is take years to pick the speed up. Okay, so that's it. It's years.
We're going to the jeweler's now, right?
Step
in. Thank you.
Well, it's not sand. It's silver and other metals and dirt.
Yeah, but you get the dirt out of it.
You burn it. You sift it to get out large pieces of stuff that you might have missed. Like, we get, you would not believe, we get big pieces of wood that when we're working on wood, we might chip a piece off, it gets covered up. We get big pieces of silver accidentally in there. So we sift through to get all that stuff out, and then you wash it, and that gets some of the dirt off. But let's face it, the stuff isn't going to melt until close to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit, so you're not worried about the dirt. It's going to burn away. What you worry about are other metals, maybe little pieces of drill bits or saw blades that are made of steel get in there, and they would make it impure. So what you have to do is add potassium nitrate, which oxidizes the base or metals and leaves you with a pure silver.
Very good.
Thanks. Have a fun time. Thank you. Let me see if I
can focus that. Yeah.
I can't get it out of my hand after a while.
Well, when you first start, you better believe it. But see, your hands get tough. You get muscles and you get calluses.
What do you polish this with?
To make it shine, pumice stone, rotten stone, jewelless rouge. I'm going to tell you one here what the weirdest thing I ever saw was. You really want to know? Last night, my 18-year-old son cleaned his room. That was the weirdest thing I ever saw.
That was a strange thing. house after how many years?
18 now. It's really bad. The Board of Health.
Well, you want to correct attention. Wear some rhinestones on your feet. So that'll do. These are for a gentleman's suit. One of those is a shaving set, the other is a drafting. And that's a practical joke.
It's got a big spider in there.
No, but it is wire, wax, silk thread, and it's 250 years old. It's in a lady's ring box, and it's a fake spider. I think it disproves 8-year-old boys will continue the same games that they always have. Perhaps.
It is cool work.
I might add that all of those colors are from natural dyes.
Dry beans.
By the 18th century, 1700s, it's Kate Ray,
Well, if you're very friendly, sir, you can just swap them around.
Usually what they do is they will, if a man inherits a millinery business, he will hire a trained milliner to organize it and run it for him. In the case of one gentle widow in Charleston, South Carolina, it doesn't take too terribly long before he marries the young lady that he hired That's right.
Didn't you tell us last time it had something to do with Milan, Italy?
Back in the 1500s, we would be Milaners. And that would be a merchant out of Italy who was supplying Europe with the rest of the fashion, you know, goods. In the 1700s, they say we're milliners because we sell over 1,000 different things. It's the 1840s, 1850s, before the trade starts to look around for a single product to focus on. And of course, the trade chooses hats, never dreaming that in the middle of this century, people would stop wearing them. So, being exclusively a hat maker is an incredibly recent development in the history of trade. And what we're doing in dressmaking right now is, fabric is so incredibly expensive that you've had it maybe 5 or 6 years, still in really good condition, very valuable fabric, but you know, the style's a little off. So you bring it in, we take it apart, and we totally reconstruct it into the new style. So, about a month and a half ago, this was a very fine 1765 gown. Well, in 1775 years old, he wants to take it apart and reconstruct it. That's right.
Now it's a mini skirt.
When we need to add longer to make it a, you know, a midi, the calf length skirt, you just take the petticoat of the skirt, add it to the gown, and you know, we can adjust it. All sorts of fun things we can do.
Really, just that, you know, your
work. What about children's clothes? Were they fashionable, or was it pretty much put on anything that fits? She's going to get something for him. Well, here it comes.
Now, this is a little bit too big. I mean, too small, so you don't have to worry about it. But this is the same sort of dress that a young gentleman would wear or his little sister would wear. Baby dresses are kind of generic until the young man gets his first baby coat. And then it's a coat with a skirt.
You would, no, you would actually.
Then when he's anywhere from 4 years old to 10 years
like
old,
you have in church.
This is mom's choice. When you take them out of their baby clothes and they get their first new three-piece suit. He's very adult, well-mannered, respectful, and of course he's got his baby clothes when he's cool. He's got a little bit
of
a little bit of a little bit of a lot of power that mom has there at that point.
Or maybe it was a matter of that.
Oh, come here.
Possibly. Yeah. But there's a lot of factors too.
I told him about that.
Yeah.
It's really neat when you're looking at portraits, because when you first look at them, it's like, this whole family's all daughters.
Yeah.
And then you start looking at what the little boy, what the children are carrying, and then you can tell the girls from the boys. Because the boy might have a sword, or a, you know, a miniature cane.
That's where mommy went to. Mommy's down the street here. Hmm? What's the matter, you bored? That's what we came here for. To bore you. I wonder who lived here. staying over here.
First tavern. The best thing about Henry's place today is the warmth in here, right?
Yeah. Right.
I tell you, it's been like this all spring, 90 one day and about 40 the next. It's been up and down like a yo-yo the whole spring, so I don't know what we're going to do about that. And you're walking up and down, loop across the street, did any one type of business stand out at all? Like taverns, yeah. About every other building, if you look closely. As many as 12 taverns here, and why would that be? This little tiny town, population about 1,600 at the time we're talking about. Well, right down the street is the answer, the capital. This is the governmental focal point for a large geographic area, the largest of the colonies Virginia is, starting on the east coast, going west of the Mississippi and north of the Great Lakes. And it's comprised of all or part of 8 of our present states. So, who was here from Wisconsin? Where is that place? Wisconsin, okay. Indiana, Illinois, any place like that, you'd all be Virginians in those days. Population about 550,000, but little old Williamsburg here. Population, as I say, about 1,600. This is the governmental focal point for that very large geographic area. Particularly in the spring and fall, that's when the courts would be in session down at the Capitol House of Burgesses meeting, a big influx of people, more than doubling the population. And when they come to town, where are they going to stay? Well, these taverns are going to be an absolute essential part of life. Your combination hotel, motel, restaurant, and place of entertainment, all rolled up into one. Who's going to be staying here at the tavern as far as the sexes go? Yeah, the men are. They're the ones involved in government at this time and in the mercantile business during this period. It does not mean that ladies are going to be bored in any way, however. Someone's going to need to keep things going on the home front. Remember the types coming here. There are very few educated and able to serve in the government. So the tendency is for the types coming here to be lawyers, plantation owners, successful merchants, and people like that. Someone's going to have to keep things going on the home front, the businesses, and managing the great many slaves that they're going to have back there. In addition, over 10 children to a family was very common. Patrick Henry had 17 children. So lots of activity going on. If you ladies were to come to town for a wedding, a funeral, particularly a social event like a dance, you'd very likely stay with friends in private residences, however, as opposed to the taverns here. These are pretty much noisy men's places. In our travels, particularly today when we're in a strange area, do we sometimes go into a motel or a restaurant and check out the prices and look at the environment, see if it's the type of place we want to stay or eat? And if it isn't, we go back out to the car and say, honey, let's drive on to the next town. Well, in the 1700s, keep in mind they're coming from great distances after a great many days of travel, coming here to Williamsburg, and they get here, and if they don't like it, are they going to be able to go on to the next town? Is there any town to go on to? No. So what does a tavern keeper have here, in a sense?
Monopoly.
A monopoly, yeah. And what's that going to allow him to do?
Charge any
price he wants, exactly. Well, the government sometimes is very beneficial. In this case, the government stepped right in, they highly regulated these taverns for that very reason. So if you travel a long distance and you get here, you're not only going to be guaranteed a place to stay, but at a moderate rate. And in doing so, they established two types of services here, public and private. So the courts would set the prices they could charge in the public areas. They're going to be minimal, just a very average, relatively on the low end price. But in addition, well, of course, if the tavern keeper could only charge those prices, is he likely going to be able to stay in business? No, he isn't. Not likely. He's going to about cover his overhead. But then private spaces like this room here called the Bullhead Room for gaming, for eating, maybe a political meeting, something of that nature, and upstairs a private room for sleeping. Those prices are negotiated. So he's going to be able to get what the traffic will bear. But the traffic coming here, the types that I mentioned, aren't they going to be able to bear quite a lot? In addition to that, it won't do any good to be able to get a high price if there's no demand. So just like in today's world, his demand's going to depend on his service and his reputation, his food. So you we've got that kind of operating situation here. Henry Weatherburn is a very experienced tavern operator. He operated the Raleigh Tavern across the street for 10 years. He didn't own it. It changed hands, so he came across the street here and opened this up in 1751. He married, and his wife was the daughter of a tavern operator. She died. In 10 days, he married Ann Shields, the widow of James Shields, the tavern operator down the street here. So he's going to stay close in touch with his highly experienced staffing here. She brought three children with her. It's a family-run operation, very successful operation, and amongst the top reputation here, and certainly a good location right near the capital here. In addition to the Weatherburn family, 12 resident slaves, and we'll visit their quarters, the last building that we go to today. So we'll continue on through the remainder of the building. It looks like Weatherburn was what we might call a workaholic type, putting his resources, all his efforts and his resources, a lot of it back into the business. He's got one of the largest collections of silver in Williamsburg, and these portraits of various kinds of tall case clock and a looking glass, indications that he would put his money back in here. And of course, these types of things are known. That's why we're using the year 1760. That's when he died. A lot of the information about Williamsburg here, it comes from inventories when people die for their state purposes. So his inventory in 1760 showed the various things that we'll see throughout. It's one of the original buildings, so you can kind of imagine as you go through the floors you walk on, it's going to be the same, and much of it very similar to the way it was in the 1700s. So let's continue our journey. He owned a farm outside of town, 1,100 acres. He lived out there, but if he got stuck here overnight, he would stay in this little room that was going to pet.
Extra stuff again.
Yeah, extra stuff.
I think this is the last one of this tonight.
Oh, Jenny, okay, this is the
one.
That's pretty nice.
This is where you'd be sleeping here in this public space. And the court set the rates at 7.5 pence per sleeping space. How many spaces do you think we might have here?
Six.
Well, you might have 16 or so here. Let's say two to a bed, the four obvious ones, but then to sleep on the floor with a bedroll is a very accepted practice. Even in the best of taverns like the Weatherburns here, you might carry your bedroll with you in a case like that one over there on the horse, or get one from Henry Weatherburn here. You probably want to get one from Henry, because he boasts out here in this laundry that they do these bedrolls and linens every 6 weeks where they need them. What are these gentlemen going to be doing in the evenings here?
Gaming.
Are they going to be going out anywhere? Is there any place to go? No, there is no place there. They're going to be confined here evening after evening for quite long hours. So lots of what going on? Drinking. Gambling. Card playing, things of that nature going on here. Lots of noisy activity. Well, remember now, it's 7.5 pence per space, so you're not running a bed. Yeah, you're going to come up and get on the left-hand side of that bed, and some other gentleman's going to be downstairs a little longer, having a couple more drinks, and he's going to crawl up those stairs a little later and get in the other side of that bed. So you're going to get some new friends here. Be all right, unless it's that same 250-pounder you've been arguing with down there all night. Now you got to sleep with him. And you may get to know him a little better than you thought, because those are rope underpinnings. They tend to stretch. Might be a little more like a hammock toward morning than it was when you went to bed. How about the decibel level of snoring that you think might be going on? Have you noticed any bathing facilities? Well, even if you notice, it doesn't mean they're going to get used very much. Bathing not high on the priority list, and they wore part of their clothing to bed that they wore during the day. So, one nice thing about that whole situation, though, is that everybody's doing the same thing. So they're all going to kind of smell the same, you know, and if you don't stand out, probably no problem. But you can kind of picture this scene here. One thing that we're lacking also, how about the bathrooms? Where are the bathrooms? Well, a couple of options there. Yeah, necessary buildings out in the back, you can see them. And then if you don't want to go out there, what?
Thunder mug.
Yeah, chamber pot. And I'll leave this whole thing up to your imagination, how that whole thing will work here in this area, floor filled with people and chamber pots around in various places.
go to a latrine. Who gets the room service here?
This is a private.
Oh, yeah, this is a private.
Private area. This is private. That's see, we can you can close it off. See.
This is like the.
That's really nice. All right.
Oh yeah, this is going to be
living
super
well.
Good because you're going to be able to order anything that you want to eat or drink or anything else.
That's not the Southern
Air. No, that's not Southern Air.
It's like 21 o'clock.
Did you find a bathroom? Serve here, likely something made in a large kettle like stew. We'll see out in the kitchen area out back. But served with home baked bread, it's going to be excellent and tasty, but a little bit different than over there in the bullhead room where we started a private area where you might get an individual meal served by an individual servant over there. Is it going to be a quiet evening by candlelight here? Anything but. Communication. We've just seen an instant war on television. How would they be able to communicate in the 1700s? Didn't they have to be physically together? Verbal communication, pretty much the only thing available. The tavern's going to provide that vehicle for the exchange of stories, maybe political debate, whatever the case, lots of noisy activity here in this particular space. Weatherburn's administrative office back here, one of the other ways they attempted to communicate was to put notices on the wall. On the right here is a price list set by the courts